Anybody who believes you can lose your salvation, this is the one question that nobody has ever been able to answer. At what point do you lose your salvation? How many sins do you have to commit in order to lose your salvation? What specific sins constitute a loss of salvation? And which ones can you keep doing to keep your salvation? Well, if it's the 1,000th sin, then what makes the 1,000th sin any greater than the 999th sin? Why is it that if I watch 5 years of inappropriate stuff on the internet, that I'm going to lose my salvation? But after 1 year, okay, it's okay. God can give me grace. I mean, how do you discern when you've actually lost it?
At what point can you lose your salvation? Is it the 500th sin? Is it the 600th sin? This is a silly question, honestly. Silly question. It isn't as simple as, oh, 500th sin, 600th sin. Now, the Bible actually answers that question easily, and we will deal with it at the very end of this lesson. We can go on with 2 Kings 20 when God saved Hezekiah from death and even gave him 15 more years. Was Hezekiah saved from death? Yes, he was saved. God even gave him 15 more years. And then he lost his salvation. Lost it. We can confirm true doctrine by the examples of the Bible. This is how we should study the Bible. Thoroughly, not lazy. So last time we talked about our dear brother Alan Parr, and we dissected some of the statements he made on a video he did with Mike Winger about the Seventh-day Adventist Church. You guys already know that there are several errors, unfortunately, that he made, not only biblical errors, but also huge errors on the research he had done on the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Now again, I want to be careful with what I say because I don't want to end up saying something that will hurt our brother Alan, but the Bible does say in Ephesians 5 and verse 11 that unfaithful works of darkness need to be reproved. Now, I'm not saying that our brother deliberately made false claims about us. I am confident that he just didn't know that some of the claims that he made were false. But these things must be exposed by the light because, again, he has a huge following and he has been leading people to biblical doctrine that might not be true. The Bible says to study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Are the teachings of Brother Alan something to be ashamed about? What I mean is this. Are there holes in his arguments that expose him to be teaching false doctrine that would cause him to be shameful of what he himself teaches? Now, it is human nature that when our wrongs are exposed, like Adam and Eve, we tend to cover ourselves with our own prideful thoughts, actions, and words to save ourselves from the shame of being wrong about something. When we claim to be teachers, we better study unbiasedly every angle of the subject we are teaching to make sure that there are no chinks in the armor. Otherwise, arrows from the enemy himself would pierce right through our faith and we would end up dead in our own shame. The Bible says in Isaiah 28, "Whom shall he teach knowledge, and whom shall he make to understand doctrine? Them that are weaned from the milk and drawn from the breasts. For precept must be upon precept, precept upon precept, line upon line, line upon line, here a little and there a little." Everything we teach must be studied thoroughly so that there are no stones unturned. Remember, Paul says, "Study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed." A workman. That means Bible study takes effort. It takes work. So we need to study thoroughly, leaving no stone unturned. The Bible says in 1 Timothy, "Now the end of the commandment is charity, out of a pure heart, and of a good conscience, and of faith unfeigned, from which some, having swerved, have turned aside unto vain jangling, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say, nor whereof they affirm." Some Bible teachers don't even know what they are talking about. They teach about things of the Bible that they don't truly understand because they have not done a thorough study on the subject. And so I contacted our brother Alan and we emailed each other back and forth. I asked them to do a live Bible study with me so that we can both understand each other's perspective when it comes to what we believe is false doctrine. He declined. I also asked if he is still interested in wanting to learn more about the investigative judgment so that he can understand it better from our perspective, and he declined, even though he goes online saying no one knows how to explain it to him thoroughly. He that is first in his own cause seemeth just, but his neighbor cometh and searcheth him. That means any story sounds true until someone tells the other side and sets the record straight. Which also means we should look at both sides of the argument before making any decision. So, you guys already know what we do here. Welcome to class. This is where we investigate, we prove and observe, and we test every doctrine with the truth of God's word. My name is Tilla, and this is the second video from a series of 8 videos where we will closely investigate our brother Alan's teachings and test them via scripture, because we all know that false doctrine cannot survive in the deep waters of truth.
I think the clearest verse in the entire New Testament as it relates to our salvation is Ephesians 2:8-9, and it says this. It says, God saved you by his grace when you believed. So let's just stop right there. If you and I are adding anything to our salvation, we are nullifying our salvation, because the very moment that you and I say we have to do something or contribute something to our salvation, then it is no longer grace, which Paul's getting ready to say right now. He says, and you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so none of us can boast about it.
Ephesians 2:8-9 says, for by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Now, this is one of the key verses that once saved, always saved teachers will use to teach that once God has given you this gift of salvation, it is 100% impossible to apostatize. While I do agree that there is, in fact, nothing we can do in order to be saved, let's ask a few questions here. I just want to say that I am not pro-Calvinism, nor am I pro-Arminianism. I am pro-Bible and Bible only. This is not an attack towards our brother Alan, but just to let people know that unfortunately there are some serious errors in his teachings. Now, I know that once someone's mind is made up, it is hard for them to change their point of view on things if they are not humble enough to acknowledge their own error, or even humble enough to investigate the opposing argument. Now, I encourage you to study for yourself and don't let anyone, including me, think for you. Be like the Bereans and search these things out. So, if we say that we are saved, what do we mean by that? What are we saved from? Psalm 116:7-8 says, return unto thy rest, O my soul, for the Lord hath dealt bountifully with thee, for thou hast delivered my soul from death. 2 Corinthians 1:9-10, but we had the sentence of death in ourselves, that we should not trust in ourselves, but in God, which raiseth the dead, who delivered us from so great a death, and doth deliver. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So, we are saved from death. We are saved from death. Matthew 1:21, the angel talking about Mary says, and she shall bring forth, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. It says he, Jesus Christ, will save his people from their sins. Okay, 1 John 2:2, and he, Jesus Christ, is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. So we are saved also from our sin. So when we say that we are saved, what do we mean by this? It means that we are saved from sin and death, and there is nothing we can do to be saved except to believe. Now let's go to Romans 11 verses 20 through 22. Our brother Alan attempts to explain this passage in a video which we are going to look at in a little bit. But let's read what it says there. It says, talking about the Israelites, which were the natural branches that were cut off. It says, because of unbelief, they were broken off, and thou standest by faith. Be not high-minded, but fear, for if God spared not the natural branches, take heed, that means be warned, take heed, lest he also spare not thee. So it's saying that if God spared not the natural branches, be warned, take heed, because he might also not spare you. Then he says, behold, therefore, the goodness and severity of God on them which fell, severity, on them which fell, severity, but toward thee, goodness, if thou continue in his goodness. Otherwise, thou also shalt be cut off. That means, or else you also will be cut off. So there are so many instances in this passage alone that tell us that you might be cut off. God might not spare you if you don't continue in his goodness. Again, is there anything we can do to be saved? No, it is a gift from God. There is nothing we can do to be saved. But is there something we can do to be cut off? According to Romans 11, yes. Now watch this. Let's take a look at how Brother Alan explains this verse.
He's speaking not to one person or an individual, speaking of that individual's salvation, but rather he's talking to a group of people, the non-Jews, Gentiles, and he's saying, look, consider how kind God has been to you, and because of that, continue in that way, and if you do not, God is going to set you aside, just like he set the Jewish people aside, and so that is what he's saying. He's not talking anywhere in here about a person's individual salvation. He's talking about a group of people and how he will relate to that group of people.
He said specifically that God can put you aside just like he put aside the Israelites. Is that what the passage said, or did it say cut off? It said cut off, not put aside. It said cut off. You can find in the Bible where Jesus even says the kingdom of God is taken from you, talking to the Israelites, talking to the nation of Israel, and given to a nation that brings forth the fruit thereof. And that's in Matthew 21 and verse 43. Israel really did get cut off, although they can still repent and be grafted back in if they so choose, says Romans 11, if we read it in its entirety. Now, Brother Alan also said that God was talking to a group, not an individual. But whether God was talking to a group or an individual, it would not matter, because whether you like it or not, you as an individual belong to a group, either the group that continues in his goodness or the group that doesn't continue in his goodness. So we can't use that kind of thinking to disregard the fact that it is possible to be cut off. To me, that is faulty logistics. To me, that is faulty logistics. Now let's take a closer look at the passage again. Romans 11 verses 20 through 22, again talking about the Israelites, which were the natural branches that were cut off. It says, because of unbelief, they were broken off, and thou standest by faith. Be not high-minded, but fear. For if God spared not the natural branches, take heed, or else, lest, that means or else, he will also not spare you. Behold, therefore, the goodness and severity of God on them which fell, severity, but toward thee, goodness, if thou continue in his goodness. Otherwise, or that means, or else, thou also shalt be cut off. This is a warning to every believer there that he was talking to. Question, whether it is a group or individual, it really doesn't matter, because groups are made up of individuals. Whether it is a group or individual, is there anything we can do to be cut off? Clearly, yes. Clearly, yes. Now, we will talk about John chapter 6 later on, but clearly, there is something we can do to be cut off. So then, what we get from all of this so far, you are a sinner who deserves death. But if you are a believer, if you believe, you are saved. No works needed. So continue in his goodness, otherwise or else you will be cut off. Colossians 1 verses 21 through 23, it says, and you that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you holy and unblameable and unreprovable in his sight, if ye continue in the faith grounded and settled and be not moved away from the hope of the gospel. Are we starting to see a pattern here? Are we starting to see a pattern? Hebrews 10, verses 23 through 27, it says, let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works, not forsaking the assembly of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching. For if we sin willfully after that we have received the knowledge of the truth, there remaineth no more sacrifice for sins, but a certain fearful looking for of judgment and fiery indignation, which shall devour the adversaries. He's talking to believers here who are saved. Then he says that we should hold firmly on our profession of faith and encourage each other to do so, especially when we see that day approaching. Because if that day actually is the second coming of Jesus Christ, when we see that day approaching, we should encourage each other to hold firmly on our profession of faith. Because if we sin willfully, there is no more sacrifice for sin. Now you are looking towards fiery indignation. You are lost. You are lost. So believers can be lost if they don't hold firmly to their profession of faith. If you are a sinner, Jesus died for you. You need only to believe and you'll be saved. But hold firmly and continue in the faith, lest that means or else you be cut off. We are starting to see a pattern. Now we will outline that pattern more clearly as we progress. Now our brother Alan post a challenge in one of his Once Saved, Always Saved videos. What was that challenge?
Anybody who believes you can lose your salvation, this is the one question that nobody has ever been able to answer. At what point do you lose your salvation? How many sins do you have to commit in order to lose your salvation? What specific sins constitute a loss of salvation? And which ones can you keep doing to keep your salvation? Nobody can answer that, right? Is it the 1,000th sin? Well, if it's the 1,000th sin, then what makes the 1,000th sin any greater than the 999th sin? Why is it that if I watch 5 years of inappropriate stuff on the internet, that I'm gonna lose my salvation, but after 1 year, okay, it's okay, God can give me grace. I mean, how do you discern when you've actually lost it?
Now, the Bible actually answers that question easily, and we will deal with it at the very end of this lesson. Let's keep going for now. Luke 13, verses 22 through 24 says, it's talking about Jesus, he went through the cities and villages, teaching and journeying toward Jerusalem. Then said one unto him, Lord, are there few that be saved? And he said unto them, watch this, strive to enter in at the straight gate. Strive to enter in at the straight gate. For many, I say unto you, will seek to enter in and shall not be able. So then what is it? Are we saved and there is nothing we can do about it? Or do we have to strive to enter in at the straight gate? And is there something we can do to be cut off? Do you know that all these three statements are true? But how do they harmonize together? Because we read all three statements in the Bible. We read all three statements in the Bible. We can't do anything to be saved, but we must strive to enter into the straight gate. But there is something we can do to be cut off. How do these things harmonize together? Watch this. Let's say I told you, don't smoke. If I told you, don't smoke. If I commanded you, don't smoke. That's the law. Then I say, if you smoke, you die. That's the condemnation of the law. You end up smoking. That's the transgression of the law. You develop lung cancer and are terminal. Again, that's the condemnation or the consequences of transgressing the law. Then I say to you, look, I love you. I don't want you to die. I will give up my lungs. I will give up my lungs and die for you to save you. So we go through surgery. Surgery is a success. You are saved. Was there anything you did in order to be saved? No. It was me. It was what I did that saved you. It was what I did that saved you. You did nothing to be saved. Question now. Would you pick up another cigarette knowing it can kill you? Again, there is nothing we can do in order to be saved. Just like you with the lung cancer, there was nothing you did to save yourself. It was me that gave you my lungs that saved you. You were saved 100%. You didn't have to do anything. You were saved 100%. But you can start smoking again and develop the same disease you had before you were saved. So what you need to do after you have been saved is to strive to not smoke anymore, or else you will die and be cut off. I'm not going to die for you a second time. Jesus is not going to die for us a second time. That's why we have a period of grace. What do I mean by that? Revelation 22 and verses 11 through 14. He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according as his work shall be. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. Blessed are they that do his commandments, that they may have right to the tree of life and may enter in through the gates into the city. Before he announces this thing, we have a period of grace. But there is going to be a time in the future where Jesus Christ stands up and says, enough is enough. Those who are holy will remain holy, and those who are filthy will remain filthy. Probation will be closed. There is actually a three-step plan of salvation that a lot of our evangelical friends don't know about. It's a three-step plan of salvation laid out in the sanctuary. A lot of our evangelical friends don't know about this, but we will talk about that later on.
Our salvation is described in the Bible as being eternal. One of the famous verses in the Bible, John 3:16, which says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whosoever believes on him should not perish, but here it is, shall have eternal life." So in other words, he doesn't say, you shall have this eternal life until you sin. You should have this eternal life until you decide to walk away. No, this is a promise straight from God that says, you know what? Whenever I save you, you have eternal life, and there's nothing that can change that.
Here is what Brother Allen forgot to mention. In this very passage, the Bible mentions that there is a condition, a requirement, which we must adhere to in order for us to be saved. And our brother just read it and didn't say anything about it. It says, "Whosoever believeth in him shall be saved, shall have eternal life." So whosoever believes will not perish, but have everlasting life. In Acts 16, Paul and Silas were in jail and they prayed for God to free them. All of a sudden, there was an earthquake and they were made free. The keeper of the prison trembled and said this, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved and thy house." In order to be saved, we must believe. Our belief is a prerequisite or a requirement of salvation. John 5, verse 24, Jesus Christ says, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Now, some Christians will use this verse to say that you can never lose eternal life. Once you believe, God gives you eternal life, and you can never lose eternal life because that life is eternal. You can't lose it. Let me ask a question now. Let's say I gave you a water bottle full of eternal water. Just because the water is eternal, does that mean that you cannot lose that water? You can still lose that water. You can choose to let go of that water. The water will remain eternal, but you can let go of it if you want to. So if you believe, you are saved. It's not your works that save you. It is your belief in Christ because He did the work to save you. But it's absolutely naive to think that there aren't people out there who genuinely believed and then stopped believing. There are people out there that genuinely believed and were baptized and then stopped believing. And our evangelical friends say they were never really saved in the first place. How? The Bible says that if you genuinely believe, you are saved. It's not your works nor your maintenance of your relationship with God that saves you. It is your genuine belief and your faith. Ultimately, that is what motivates you to display your belief through your actions and your good works. The reality is that there are people out there that at one point really believed, genuinely believed, and were even baptized. And then 10 years later, they were lost. They stopped believing. Now, the author of Hebrews talks about the seventh-day Sabbath in Hebrews 4, and then he says this, "There remaineth therefore a rest to the people of God. For he that is entered into his rest, he also hath ceased from his works, as God did from his," talking about the seventh-day Sabbath. "Let us labor therefore," let us what? Labor therefore, this reminds me of that one verse, let's strive to enter in. "Let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief." Wait a minute, so we just learned that after we are saved, our response should be to continue in the faith and strive to enter in at the straight gate. Hebrews says, "Let us labor therefore to enter in, or else we will fall to unbelief." That means it is possible for people to fall to unbelief. How? Probably because they didn't labor to enter in. They did not practice their faith. This is not only scripturally true, but it's also practically true. It is a reality. There are people who truly believed, meaning they were saved because they believed, and then they stopped believing. If the condition of being saved is that you believe, and if it is possible to fall to unbelief, what does that mean? It means you can lose your salvation. You can lose your salvation. In Mark 9, there was a father who had a son with an unclean spirit, and he asked Jesus to heal him. Look what it says, Mark 9, verses 23 and 24. Jesus said unto him, "If thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth." And straightway, the father of the child cried out and said with tears, "Lord, I believe. Help thou my unbelief." So this father did believe, but there was a part of him that did not believe. He asked Christ to help him because he was in danger of falling to unbelief. It is possible to fall to unbelief. Hebrews 3, verses 12 to 14, it says, "Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God." First of all, we can't depart from someone we were never with to begin with. So we can't use the excuse of he was never saved to begin with. Because it says there that there are people who will depart from the living God. So again, "Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. But exhort one another daily, while it is called today, lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. For we are made partakers of Christ, if we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. If we hold the beginning of our confidence steadfast unto the end. So if you believe, are you saved? Yes. If you don't believe, are you saved? No. Is it possible to fall to unbelief? Clearly, yes. We can only be partakers of Christ if we hold fast our confidence unto the end. If we hold fast our confidence unto, that means our faith unto the end. Confidence, that means faith. To have confidence in someone, that means to have faith in someone. So if we hold fast to our faith and our confidence in Christ, then we will be saved. But if we don't, we are lost. That is why it says in Matthew 24 and verse 13, but he that shall endure unto the end, the same shall be saved. Again, we see the same pattern here. We are sinners in need of a Savior. Jesus died in our place, saving us from sin and death. After being saved, we must continue in and practice our faith, or else we will be cut off. There are so many angles we can look into for clarity on this subject. Countless. But we don't have time to look at all of these things. Let's do one more though. In Luke 8, Jesus teaches the parable of the sower. Luke 8 verses 5 through 8. A sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and it was trodden down, and the fowls of the air devoured it, and some fell upon a rock, and as soon as it was sprung up, it withered away because it lacked moisture, and some fell among the thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it, and other fell on good ground and sprang up and bare fruits an hundredfold. And when he said these things, he cried, he that hath ears to hear, let him hear. Now let's see what is the interpretation. Luke 8, verses 11 through 13. Jesus says, now the parable is this. The seed is the word of God. Those by the wayside are they that hear. Then cometh the devil and taketh away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. Okay, so remember, those who believe will be saved, right? It says so right there. Now watch this. They on the rock are they which, when they hear, receive the word with joy, and these have no root, which for a while believe, they were saved, and in time of temptation fall away. The Bible says that God is love. 1 John 4 and verse 8. It says that God is love. It's who He is. That's His character. God is love. Now the beauty of true love, the beauty in true love is that we do not have to be programmed like robots to have a relationship with the Lord. If we are programmed against our own choice, if we are programmed against our own will to say, I love you to God, then it's not love. When my wife and I got married, the sweetest thing, the sweetest feeling was when she said, I do, when she had the option to say, I don't. That's love. That's love. If God has to bind us and force His love on us against our own will, number one, that is a hostage situation. And number two, that's not love, that's rape. That's not love, that's rape. God is love. He's not going to force us to love Him.
Jude chapter 1, verse 24. It says this, to Him, speaking to God, who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you before His glorious presence without fault and with great joy. So this verse clearly says that God is powerful enough to keep you from stumbling or falling away from Him.
Now, I also believe that He is able to keep me from falling. But am I going to let Him work in my life so that He can keep me from falling? That's the question. Notice, the verse did not say He will forcefully keep you from falling. It says that He is 100% fully capable of keeping you from falling. Here, Brother Allen uses Jude 24 to prove that we can never lose our salvation, even though that's not what it's saying. It says that God is able to keep us from falling. Again, it does not say that God will forcefully keep you from falling. Genuine question for our Brother Allen here. Are you still falling? If you say no, you are no longer falling, that's a lie. If you say that you are still falling after saying that God will keep you from falling, what happened? After the claim that God is powerful enough to keep you from falling, why then are you still falling? The problem is not God. He is capable, fully capable of keeping you from falling. The problem is that you don't practice that thing, that phrase, that verse in faith. And if you don't strive to exercise your faith by keeping His commandments, you can be cut off. But God knows that it's going to take some time for our Christian character to be developed and to be perfected. And so He gave us this grace period to practice and exercise our faith so that it can be established and be perfected. Again, we will dive into what I'm talking about later on. But let's go to Titus 2 and verses 11 and 12. It says, "For the grace of God," the what of God? "The grace of God that bringeth salvation hath appeared to all men." And what does it do? It teaches us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Remember, we are saved by grace through faith. And that grace is the same grace that teaches us to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Not the world to come, this present world. This is why grace is given. This period of grace here on earth allows us time to practice and exercise our faith and to correct every fault we have before judgment day so that we can stand blameless and perfect during that day. And again, it is God who keeps us from falling, not ourselves. We will have to practice our faith in God and rely on Him to finish our faith. We will talk more about that later. Let's take a look at John chapter 6 now. John 6 verses 37 through 40 says, "All that the Father giveth me," Jesus talking, "shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in no wise cast out, for I came down from heaven not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. And this is the Father's will, which hath sent me, that of all which he hath given me I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day. And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day." Now let's take a look at what our brother Allen says about this passage.
"And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall," here it is, "lose none of all those he has given me, but raise them up at the last day." So you know what Jesus is saying here? He's saying every single believer throughout the history of time that my Father has entrusted to me, not only have I not cast them out, but I have not lost one of them. In other words, he's saying, I've got an undefeated record. Every believer that's come to me, I've not ever lost one.
This sounds nice and all, but let's really read what it is saying here. Again, it says, "And this is the Father's will, which hath sent me, that of all which he hath given me, I should lose nothing." So God's will is that Jesus should lose none of those who God gave him. Hard question for everyone here. Is God's will always done? Hard question. Hard question. Is God's will always done? Some of us might say yes. Let's see what the Bible actually says. 2 Peter 3 and verse 9. "The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is longsuffering to usward, not willing," that means this is not his will, "it is not his will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." So, God is not willing, that means it is not his will that any should perish. Any should perish. but that all should come to repentance. But do all come to repentance? No. If you look at the book of Revelation and almost every book in the Bible, not all come to repentance. That's not God's will. God's will is that all should come to repentance. But we know in reality that all don't come to repentance. Only a few come to repentance. So God's will is not being done in most people's lives. This does not mean that God is defeated. It means that we are faulty human beings and some of us don't want to rely on God to give us victory over sin. John chapter 6 says that it is God's will that Jesus should lose nothing, none. But if precept must be applied with precept, if precept is upon precept, God's will is not always being done in an individual's life because most of us don't want God. You are still a sinner, and that is proof that God's will is not being done in your life. This is because you don't hold fast to the fact that God is able to keep you from falling. Psalm 40 and verse 8 says, I delight to do thy will, O my God, yea, thy law is within my heart. What is God's will? For us to delight in his law. His will is for us to keep his law. Are you keeping his law? If not, then God's will is not being done in your life. So then what prevents God's will from being done in our lives? It's that thing called choice. Choice. So if you believe, are you saved? Yes. But after you are saved, is it possible for you to prevent God's will from being produced in your life? Clearly, that is a high possibility for all of us. Clearly, that's a reality. And if you are preventing God's will from being done in your life, are you still saved? Or did you just prove that you became like the rocky ground that once believed and then fell away?
Another very strong scripture that supports the idea of once saved, always saved is John chapter 10, verse 28 and 29, which says this, I give them eternal life and they shall never perish. Now watch this. No one will snatch them out of my hand. Verse 29, my Father who has given them to me is greater than all and no one can snatch them out of my Father's hands. I and the Father are one. So notice it says no one is powerful enough to snatch us out of God's hands. Now I know what you're thinking. You're gonna say, you know what? But yeah, we can take ourselves out of God's hand. You know what? We cannot do that because it clearly says no one can take us out of his hand. And that means we are included in the no one.
Again, I'm starting to notice a pattern here. Our brother Alan is again, I hate to say this because I don't want to offend our brother here, but he is reading out of context. And this is a theme, unfortunately, for most of his videos. A lot of times he assumes things and he reads things out of context and he doesn't confirm what he believes about this scripture with another scripture. Remember, the Bible says, out of the mouth of two or three witnesses shall truth be established. He doesn't do that. He just uses one verse and he formulates his opinion and that's it. And he's also making the passage say what he sincerely thinks it says. Now, in order to truly understand something, we must study and study and study the subject and ask many questions to truly understand everything about that subject. Question, who is the them that is not plucked out of the hands of God? Let's read the passage again, this time in context. Jesus speaking, he says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I give unto them, the who? Them, the sheep, his sheep, eternal life. And they shall never perish, neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them me, is greater than all, and no man is able to pluck them out of my Father's hand. I and my Father are one. So, who is the them here? His sheep. Who are his sheep? It clearly says those who follow him. They are the ones that are not plucked out of his hand, so long as they are his sheep who follow him. Is it possible to stop being the sheep of Christ? Is it possible to stop following him? Again, we demonstrated that earlier, but let's entertain this thought. 1 Timothy 4 and verse 1 says, "Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith." Some shall depart from the faith. That means they were in the faith and then they will depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Now, some say that in context, this is talking about marrying and abstaining from meat. Yes, Paul gave examples of doctrines from devils that people in the future will give heed to, but the point is still clear that there are going to be people that were in the faith who will depart from the faith. They will no longer follow Christ, forfeiting their place in heaven. Remember, Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they follow me, and they will never be plucked out of my hands." What else is a characteristic of the sheep of Christ? Let's go back to John 10, verse 14. Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd, and know my sheep, and am known of mine." So in order to be the sheep of Christ, we must know him, and he must know us. 1 John 2 and verse 4 says, "He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar, and the truth," Jesus Christ, "is not in him." If you say you know Christ, but don't keep his commandments, yes, all 10 of the commandments, including the Sabbath, you are a liar, and the truth is not in you. You don't really know him. Matthew 7 verses 22 and 23 says, "Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that worketh iniquity." That word iniquity means lawlessness. So then if you are committing lawlessness, which is the transgression of God's law, the Ten Commandments, Jesus says he never knew you. So then if you are not upholding God's commandments, are you part of his sheep? You are susceptible to being plucked out of God's hands, because only God's sheep can never be plucked out. Those who keep his commandments can never be plucked out of God's hands. There are people out there who truly believe in the finished work of Christ's saving act. They are saved. No works of their own was needed. But if, after believing and being saved, they don't continue in his goodness nor strive to enter in at the straight gate, they are forfeiting their position of being the sheep of Christ. If we are going to call ourselves teachers, we must thoroughly and deeply study the Bible, leaving no stone unturned. This is why so many teachers have different interpretations. They don't study the subject completely, and they put their own preconceived opinions on Scripture.
If you believe that you can lose your salvation, you are denying the finished work of Christ on the cross. What you're basically saying without saying it is, you know what? Whatever Jesus did on the cross was good enough to get me in the door, but it wasn't really good enough to really complete my salvation. And so therefore, thank you, Jesus, for getting my foot in the door. Okay, I feel you. Thank you, bruh. But you know what? I have to take it from here.
I see that the biggest problem is that most teachers that teach this once saved, always saved doctrine don't know the three-step plan of salvation laid out in the sanctuary of God. Now let's go to Acts chapter 16. Right before Paul and Silas went to prison, they had an encounter with a demon-possessed girl. It says, "And it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. The same followed Paul and us, and cried, saying, These men are the servants of the Most High, which show unto us the way of salvation." Now, even though the damsel was possessed, she told the truth that Paul showed the way of salvation. Now, that word way is the word hodos, which means road or path. So Paul was showing people the way or the path to salvation. Now watch this, Isaiah 56 and verse 1. "Thus saith the Lord, keep ye judgment and do justice, for my salvation is near to come, and my righteousness to be revealed." Isaiah 61, verse 10, I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation. He hath covered me with the robe of righteousness. So salvation and righteousness are interconnected. Now, if Paul knew the way of salvation, then he also knew the way of righteousness. Now, watch this. Psalm 5 in verse 8. Lead me, O Lord, in thy righteousness because of mine enemies. Make thy way straight before my face. He says, lead me, O Lord. Make thy way straight. You lead and I follow, so I can follow in your righteousness. That's salvation. Proverbs 12, verse 28. In the way of righteousness is life, and in the pathway thereof there is no death. Proverbs 15 and verse 9. The way of the wicked. The what? The way of the wicked is an abomination unto the Lord, but he loveth him that followeth after righteousness. If we follow the way of righteousness, we are saved. We have life. Now, this is just a side note. 2 Peter 2, verses 20 through 22. For if, after they have escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled therein. So can you be entangled again with the pollutions of the world? Yes. They are again entangled therein and overcome. The latter end is worse with them than the beginning. For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness. What? For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness. That means to be saved. It would have been better for them not to have known salvation. Then, after they have known it, to turn from the holy commandments delivered unto them. But it is happened unto them, according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again. The word to know in the Bible means to have an intimate relationship or an intimate knowledge with something or someone. In Genesis 4, it says that Adam knew his wife and she conceived. And then Adam knew his wife again and they conceived Seth. That word to know means to have a deep connection with someone or something. The particular word there in 2 Peter 2 is the Greek word epignosko, which means to be fully acquainted with. Again, it says, for if, after they have escaped the pollutions of the world, they are again entangled therein and overcome. The latter end is worse with them than the beginning. For it had been better for them not to have known or have a deep connection with the way of righteousness, which is salvation, than after they had known it, to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it has happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again. They would have lost their salvation. They would get cut off. The latter end of them is worse than the beginning. Anyways, Paul knew the way of salvation, which is the way of righteousness. If we follow this way of righteousness, we are saved. Well, what is that way? How can we find it? Remember, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Psalm 77 verse 13 says, thy way, O God, is in the sanctuary. This is how we can know the path or God's way of salvation. It is in the sanctuary. Now, we have done an in-depth study on this before, and I provided a link to the playlist of the study in the description box, but I will summarize it for you. So in the sanctuary, there are three parts: the courtyard, the holy place, and the most holy place. There are different furniture placed in different parts of the sanctuary. The altar of sacrifice and the laver are placed in the courtyard. The table of showbread, the seven candle lampstand, and the altar of incense are placed in the holy place. And the only thing that is placed in the most holy place is the Ark of the Covenant that contains the Ten Commandments. In the Old Testament, during the sanctuary service, we have the sinner taking his lamb to the north side of the courtyard to confess his sins and to transfer them to the head of the lamb. And then he must kill the lamb. Then the sinner must slice the fat out of the lamb, and then he is free to go. At that point, he, the sinner, is saved and is sin-free. He is justified. He is declared sanctified. Declared sanctified. That doesn't mean he is truly sanctified. He didn't go to the process. He did not go through the process of sanctification, but he is declared justified and sanctified. His sins were transferred unto the Lamb. The common priest then takes the blood of the lamb and the fat of the lamb to the altar of sacrifice. He places the blood on the four corners of the altar and places the fat on the altar itself for a burnt offering. What does this sacrifice symbolize? It symbolizes Jesus Christ. It symbolizes the death of Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, for the remission of our sins. Once we place our sins on the Lamb, and once the Lamb is sacrificed, the sinner is saved, declared justified. What does that mean for us today? When we confess our sins, God is faithful to forgive, and from that point on, you are sin-free. We are sin-free and saved. There was nothing the sinner could do to be saved. It was the sacrifice that saved him. But once you have confessed your sin and are sin-free, from that point on, is there a possibility that you can sin and fall again? Yes. Yes, this is why God gave us a grace period. Again, we will talk about that later on. Now, the next furniture after the altar of sacrifice is the laver. Before the common priest could enter into the holy place, he must wash himself with the water that was in the laver at the courtyard right in front of the door of the holy place. What does the washing of water symbolize? It symbolizes baptism. So the courtyard is the part of salvation where you are justified. So then the first part of salvation is justification. Your sins are transferred onto the Lamb, and the Lamb died for you. You are saved. You don't need to work for your salvation. You are saved. The washing of water symbolizes the washing away of your spiritual filth. That's baptism. But there is still a problem. You are still a sinner. God will deal with that in the next compartment of the sanctuary. What is the next compartment of the sanctuary? The holy place. Now, there were millions of Israelites at the camp. So there was no way that every Israelite was able to make a sacrifice in the sanctuary in one day. So at 9 a.m. and at 3 p.m., the common priest would sacrifice a lamb for all of Israel collectively. So he would sacrifice the lamb. And as he is sacrificing the lamb, the Israelites at the camp would be praying and confessing their sins to transfer their sins unto the lamb. And then the priest would enter into the holy place, of course, after washing himself at the laver. Then he places the blood of the lamb on the four corners of the altar of incense. At the altar of incense, this is where the common priest would be praying intercessory prayer for the Israelites, interceding for them. Psalm 141 verse 2 says, "Let my prayers be set forth before thee as incense, and the lifting up of my hands as the evening sacrifice." The smoke of the incense was a symbol for the prayers of the saints as the priest is interceding for the saints. This is a symbol of Jesus' intercession for us right after he ascended to heaven. Remember, our brother Alan says that there is no more work that Jesus Christ had to do after his death on the cross. Actually, there is. He has to intercede for us in the holy place. That's what he was doing after his resurrection, after the cross. He went up to intercede for us. That was the work that he had to do. Now, what else do we see in the holy place? The table of showbread. What does it represent? Remember, Jesus said, "I am the bread of life." Who is he? The Word of God. Jesus also said in the Gospels, "Man must not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceed from the mouth of God." The bread, or the showbread, represents God's Word. We also see in the holy place the seven candle lampstand. In Revelation, Jesus himself said in chapters 1 and 4 that the seven lamps seen in the holy place are the seven spirits of God. So the seven candle lampstand would represent the Holy Spirit. If you notice, the representations of each piece of furniture in the holy place represent three vital aspects to the second part of salvation, which is sanctification. Reading the bread of life, which is the word of God. We need the Holy Spirit, and we need a consecrated life of prayer and communion with God. If we don't have these three things being displayed in our daily lives, then we are not living a sanctified life, and we cannot get into the next compartment, which is the most holy place. Now, the only furniture in the most holy place is the Ark of the Covenant, in which the two tables of the Ten Commandments are placed. In the Old Testament, God's throne is called the mercy seat, which is above the lid of the Ark of the Covenant. And that is where God himself resides. This is where he sits. This is why the last compartment is called the most holy place. It is because God's very presence is in there. The last part of salvation is when we finally see God and bask in his presence. When the high priest enters the most holy place, he must be blameless and without sin. And it is the same with us today. If we want to be in the presence of God, we must be found blameless and without sin. This cannot happen until after the resurrection, where the dead in Christ rise in their glorified bodies, and we which are alive and remain in the twinkling of an eye transform into our glorified bodies as well. Only then will we be able to be in the presence of the Lord. This is called glorification. We will talk more about this in a future video in this series. Now, what is the three-step plan of salvation? It is justification, sanctification, and glorification. Justification, this is the part of salvation where Christ would die for the sinner. The sinner didn't have to do anything to be saved. He is saved and wiped clean of his sins by the shed blood of Jesus Christ. You are justified. And then we have sanctification. After the sinner is saved, God gives him a time of grace in which the sinner must continue in his goodness. This is the process of character reformation in which the Christian must maintain his relationship with God in such a way that he is perfected. He will constantly fall and get up, fall and get up, fall and get up, and severely tried and tested. There will be a struggle between righteousness and unrighteousness in his very being. He will endure these trials as opportunities to exercise his faith until he gets to the point of complete surrender to God and obedience to God's commandments. Not in order to be saved, but because he realizes the love of God which saved him. Sanctification is crucial because it really shows who among the saved will actually be completely surrendered to God. So surrendered that he will bear the fruits of the Spirit and start to behave like Christ. Those who are saved but refuse to surrender and be sanctified during this time, just as Scripture says, will be cut off. They will forfeit their own salvation. They will lose their salvation. And then we have glorification. Now, before we are glorified, there must be a judgment that takes place. And that judgment is when God looks at our works, because our works prove our faith. We're going to take a look at that later on in this series. Now, there is a grace period which teaches us to live our lives in harmony with Christ's character. That grace period will come to a close, and those who are holy will remain holy, and those who are filthy will remain filthy. This is the part of salvation where finally we can go home and bask in the presence of God. Glorification. That's when Jesus Christ comes back and we are transformed in the twinkling of an eye. We are transformed into our glorified body and we go up to God. Now let's go back to our lung cancer illustration. If I told you don't smoke, is that the law? Yes. If you smoke, it can kill you. Is that the condemnation of the law? Yes. Don't smoke is the command, and death is the condemnation of breaking that command. If you smoked and got lung cancer, and I died for you and gave you my lungs so that you can live, did you do anything to be saved? No, you are saved by me, not by your works, so that you can't boast about your salvation. But here's the problem now. Do you think that after being addicted to smoking, and that even though you are saved, you won't get any cravings? Of course you will. That is a problem. How do we deal with that now? You need time in order for you to practice saying no to your temptation. God gave us a period of grace from when Jesus died and resurrected in order for us to finally learn that we can be strengthened by Christ to say no to our temptations and gain the victory over sin. That is what sanctification is for. Did you know that we have 3 periods on earth? We have the fallen period. That means you are a sinner and you're gonna die. This is the disqualification stage. But in our fallen period, God saves you by grace, not by works. That is the justification stage. And then we have the grace period. In this grace period, we can learn to love God and keep His commandments. That's the sanctification stage. This is a period in which we, as a saved people, allow God to perfect our character. God gives us time to be able to develop that perfect Christ-like character, not by our own strength, but by the strength of Jesus Christ, because God is able to keep us from falling. This is the sanctification stage. And then we have the judgment period. This is where God is going to divide the sheep from the goats. If you don't keep God's commands, you die, because it is a sign that you chose not to have a relationship with God. That's again, you are again being brought back to the disqualification stage. If you do have a relationship with God, keeping God's commands is automatic, and it is a sign that proves that you chose to have a relationship with God, and therefore you live because of it. That's glorification. Again, if you believe, you are saved, not by your works. Your works is proof that you have a relationship with God after being saved. Can a homosexual be saved? Yes, if he believes. After he is saved, can he still continue in his life of homosexuality? He can. But if he turns back to his old lifestyle, he forfeits his salvation. We can't use the old, he was never saved to begin with. If the man genuinely believed, he was saved. Him going back to his old ways doesn't mean he wasn't saved, but it would prove that he doesn't want to be sanctified, therefore forfeiting his salvation. If we truly believe, we are saved. But we still have temptations of sinning. That's why God gave us this grace period, to give us time to overcome sin. God will help you overcome because He loves you. If you don't believe, just take a look at His Son. What did He do? He overcame temptation. Jesus was tempted at all points as we are, but He went through it as a human being to show us that it is possible to gain the victory over sin as a human being in the flesh. His goal was to show us that it is possible to condemn sin in the flesh, just as He condemned sin in the flesh. Satan tried 3 times to get Him to use His divine power to satisfy His temptation. If Jesus would have turned those rocks into bread or threw Himself off that high place, Satan would have proved that you need to be divine to overcome sin. But did Jesus use His divine power to overcome sin? No. What did He use? He used "it is written" to overcome sin and condemn sin in the flesh, showing us that it is possible for a man to condemn sin in the flesh if only we connect with God. He will give us the victory over sin and sanctify us. Again, the Bible gives us a pattern. We are in our fallen state and we deserve the punishment of death. Jesus took that punishment for us, meaning we are saved. not by our own works, but because God loves us, because He is love, then we must continue in His goodness and strive to have a relationship with God that it will show through our actions and works. If our works don't show our faith, it is an indication that we have fallen away and therefore have forfeited our salvation because we don't want to be sanctified. Now let's confirm, are there examples of this pattern in the Bible? 1 Samuel 10 says this, "The Spirit of the Lord will come upon thee, and thou shalt prophesy with them, and shalt be turned into another man, shall be transformed into another man. And let it be, when these signs are come unto thee, that thou do as occasion serve thee. For God is with thee, and thou shalt go down before me to Gilgal, and behold, I will come down unto thee to offer burnt offerings, and to sacrifice sacrifices of peace offerings. 7 days shalt thou tarry, till I come to thee, and show thee what thou shalt do." And it was so, that when he had turned his back to go from Samuel, God gave him another heart, and all those signs came to pass that day. Was Saul in the favor of God? Yes, Saul was in the favor of God. Favor means grace. Grace. Watch. 1 Samuel 15, verse 10 and 11 says this, "Then came the word of the Lord unto Saul, saying, It repenteth me that I have set up Saul to be king, for he is turned back from following me." He what? He stopped following me, says God. He's turned back from following me. He did follow me, and then he stopped. "And hath not performed my commandments. And it grieved Saul, and he cried unto the Lord all night." 1 Samuel 16, verse 14, "But the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul." Saul was in the grace of God. He was following God, and then he turned back from following God and stopped following God. And the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul. He grieved the Holy Spirit. Watch, 1 Samuel 28 and verse 6, "And when Saul inquired of the Lord answered him not, neither by dreams, nor by Urim, nor by prophets." Saul was lost. He lost his salvation. He had the grace of God. He was in favor with God. And then he lost his salvation because he stopped following God. We talked about this earlier. Watch, Jude verse 5 says this, "I will therefore put you in remembrance, though ye once knew this, how that the Lord, having saved the people out of the land of Egypt, afterward destroyed them that believed not." The Israelites were saved from what exactly? From Egypt. They were saved. They were saved. And then they what? They believed not. And God destroyed them because they fell to unbelief. They were saved, but then they fell to unbelief, and then God destroyed them. They lost their salvation. Now watch, Exodus 20 and verse 2 says, "I am the Lord thy God, which have brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage." So according to Exodus 20, Egypt was called the house of bondage. Now if we do a proof text on the word bondage, it is actually symbolic for sin or the bondage of sin. So the Israelites were saved from sin and ultimately death from sin. Remember, Aaron and his boys, Nadab and Abihu, were in the number of those who were saved. Again, not by their own works, but by the works of God. In fact, if you go to Psalm 44, it talks about the works that God performed to save the Israelites of old out of the land of Egypt. So Nadab and Abihu were saved, but not by their own works. Leviticus 10 verses 1 and 2, "And Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, took either of them his censer, and put fire in them, and put incense thereon, and offered strange fire before the Lord, which he commanded them not. And there went out fire from the Lord, and devoured them, and they died before the Lord." Here are two Hebrew boys that were saved, but because they did not continue in the commandments of God, they lost their salvation. We can go on with 2 Kings 20 when God saved Hezekiah from death and even gave him 15 more years. Was Hezekiah saved from death? Yes. God gave him 15 more years even. What did he do with those 15 years? Did he continue in the goodness of God? No, he went and boasted about his riches and started showing off and became prideful, and God punished him by allowing the Babylonians to take over his kingdom. He was saved. God even gave him 15 more years, and then he lost his salvation. Lost it. I mean, there are so many examples of people losing their salvation in the Bible. Judas, Ananias and his wife, etc., etc. That is how we can confirm true doctrine. We can confirm true doctrine by the examples of the Bible. This is how we should study the Bible. Thoroughly, not lazy, thoroughly. Now, for our brother Alan's question.
Anybody who believes you can lose your salvation, this is the one question that nobody has ever been able to answer. At what point do you lose your salvation? How many sins do you have to commit in order to lose your salvation? What specific sins constitute a loss of salvation? And which ones can you keep doing to keep your salvation? Nobody can answer that, right? Is it the 1,000th sin? Well, if it's the 1,000th sin, then what makes the 1,000th sin any greater than the 999th sin? Why is it that if I watch 5 years of inappropriate stuff on the internet, that I'm going to lose my salvation, but after 1 year, okay, it's okay, God can give me grace? I mean, how do you discern when you've actually lost it?
At what point can you lose your salvation? Is it the 500th sin? Is it the 600th sin? This is a silly question, honestly. Silly question. Remember, once you are saved, you enter into the process of sanctification, where you allow God to work in your life so that you can overcome sin, so that your Christian character is perfected by God. Revelation 3 and verse 5 says this, "He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels." Those who what? Those who overcome. Their names will not be blotted out. Question, if your name is in the book of life, are you going to die or are you going to have life? Obviously, you're going to have life. So if your name is in the book of life and you have life, and if Christ blots out your name out of the book of life, what happens? What happens? Do you lose your salvation? Remember, you have life if your name is in the book of life. But is it possible for Christ to blot out your name? Yes, we just read that. Again, the Bible says that those who overcome sin, those are going to be the ones whose names remain in the book of life. Which means those who do not overcome sin, those are going to be the ones whose names are blotted out from the book of life. So since their names were on the book of life, it means that they had life or they were saved. But because they did not rely on God to give them the victory over sin so that they can overcome sin, their names are blotted out. So can your name be blotted out? If your name can be blotted out, can you then lose your salvation? Yes. As soon as Christ blots out your name, you have lost your salvation. You've lost it. Exodus 32, verse 33. "And the Lord said unto Moses, whosoever hath sinned against me, him will I blot out of my book." When God blots out your name out of the book of life, that is when you lost your salvation. It isn't as simple as, oh, 500th sin, 600th sin. Are you living a life of repentance and complete surrender to God? You see, this is why God gave us a grace period, because he knew that we're going to continue sinning and sinning and sinning and sinning. But God gives us this grace period so that we can practice our faith in God, so that we can rely on him to keep us from falling. God is giving us this time so that we can be perfected, so that our Christian character would be perfected, not by us, but by relying on God himself, because he is able to keep us from falling. Problem is, do you believe that? If you do, you would act it. If you don't, you wouldn't. Watch. Again, Titus 2, verses 11 and 12 says, "For the grace of God," the what? "The grace of God, that bringeth what? Salvation, hath appeared unto all men, teaching us," what teaches us? "The grace of God, teaches us that denying ungodliness and worldly lust, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. This once saved, always saved doctrine is such a dangerous doctrine because it gives people a false sense of security that leads people not to even think about being sanctified or overcoming sin. We are saved not by our own works, but we must also be sanctified before being glorified and entering the presence of God. Would you like to enter God's presence? Would you like to enter God's presence? Then accept Christ today. Repent today. Get baptized today and be saved. And after you are saved, continue in His goodness and strive to enter in. Today is the day of salvation. Praise God always. Father in heaven, first of all, we want to thank you for the opportunity to study this subject. Thank you, Father, for allowing us the freedom to do a careful investigation of the plan of salvation. Father, it is my prayer that those who view this video will read these things for themselves and not let anyone else think for them, and that includes me, Father. Father, help us to understand that every time the Bible is opened in front of us, it is serious business. Help us to understand, Father, that if we teach doctrine, it has the potential to lead people astray. Help us, Father, to be respectful of your word and to be responsible and careful with the teaching thereof. My prayer again, Father, is that this video is not so harsh, that the things presented in this video will spark a deep interest in the viewer to open their own Bibles. Help us, Father, to discern dangerous doctrines and lead us in the way everlasting. Be with my brother Alan, Father, and impress upon him a deeper study of the Word of God. And that goes for me as well, and the viewers of this video. And I pray this, Father, earnestly in Jesus' name. Amen. Do you want to learn how to break down Bible verses and passages the same way that we do at School for Prophets? If you do, become an SFP patron at the SFP Patreon page. Link is in the description, by the way. And every week, we will break down a Bible verse or a passage using the SFP study system. You will learn how to identify key words and key phrases, define those key words and phrases using scripture, and chase those key words and phrases to get a deeper understanding of scripture and, of course, prophecy. Sign up now and become a patron and get started with our lessons. The link is in the description box. Praise God always.